this consensus over long centuries and great distances was merely architectural, nothing more. Architecture can be a bond, but not here. Here it was a mask which disguised schisms. It papered over the northern post-Reformation appetite for ever-dividing communions, communions whose dogmatic differences seem mere hair-splitting to the outsider. Such factionalism was mocked in the 1650s by Andrew Marvell. Sure, when religion did itself embark and from the east would westward steer its arc, it struck, and splitting on this unknown ground, each one thence pillaged the first piece he found. Hence Amsterdam. Turk, Christian, pagan, Jew, staple of sects and mints of schism grew. That bank of conscience where not one so strange opinion but finds credit and exchange. Edam. There is a Dutch saying that when three people meet, they form a sect, and when a fourth joins, the sect splits in two over doctrinal differences. This is the one and true cheese. These are apostate cheeses because they are flavoured with caraway and with cloves. And this is the cheese of heretics because it is flavoured with pepper. May they sneeze in hell.
Numerous mutually tolerant confessions coexisted in the early 1600s. This coexistence was encouraged by those whose enduring god was money, for they stood to gain from it. A merchant guild or fellowship whose members are of different faiths and cultures is less restricted in whom it can do business with than one which is uniformly composed.
Sectarianism diminishes religion's temporal power. Countless diverging sects cannot exercise the sort of control that a single church can. Religion then ceases to dominate the everyday. It becomes what you might call a faith-style choice, an add-on. The North is where religion began to grow up, began to self-secularize.
The first graphic step in that process was iconoclasm, stripping churches of idolatrous images which are no more than jujus. The resultant post-Reformation church interiors, bereft of amulets, were the invariable subject of the paintings made in the first half of the 1600s by the Haarlem master Pieter Sanradon. The extent of their secularization is made obvious. Churches had become public parks with a roof. You might amble, converse, hang out, lie around, visit as a tourist, or make paintings of them. Sanradam's paintings are spellbinding in their stillness, lack of incident, lack of all but a few isolated individuals who are engaged in anything but worship. All Sanradam took from van der Weyden, let alone Bosch, was an obsession with meticulous detail. Otherwise, he's cold, dispassionate, objective. He invented an art of self-proclaiming understatement. It appears worryingly bland, stubbornly mute. Nothing happens, in a most emphatic way. Yet the very absences provoke foreboding and discomfiture. They persuade the spectator to wonder what is not being shown. They imply an unspoken mystery, a metaphysical mystery, not a transcendental mystery.
He talks quietly and subtly about the sheer marvellousness of human life, human sensibility, human ingenuity. Sanradam's achievement was peculiar, and it was for centuries unacknowledged. It was not till the 20th century, till the advent of the machine age, that his austerity and blankness rang a bell. His detachedness became a northern norm, so widely emulated that there is, effectively, a continuous school of Sanradam, self-consciously glacial, non-committal, and as pregnant with possibility as those churches where something may or may not be about to happen, something terrible.
His bleakly humanistic example is discernible in the work of a school of painters who are hardly known in Britain because Britain looked south gave slavering forelock to the broad brush marks of Mediterranean satyrs. So northern painters such as the Dutchman Karel Willink and the Weimar Republic artists Richard Oelzer, Christian Schad, Franz Radziwill are absurdly overlooked, and so too are their current peers, no matter how brilliant they may be.
My name is Annemarie Buschers, painter. I live and work in Groningen.
Who is it?
My husband Thomas.
How many portraits have you made of him?
Three.
Manfred Jürgens, ich bin Maler und Fotograf.
There's no greater dockscape in northern Europe than Hamburg's. International trade required a common language. When the globe was not yet a globe, when you could still fall off the edge, the lingua franca spoken from Flanders as far as the easternmost Baltic was Plattdeutsch, the German of the coastal flatlands of the still flat world.
This pigeon of convenience was picked up in taverns and prisons and brothels.